predictions, it's probably worthwhile to understand the theory of, you know, how you invert elements, because the free algebra. So we're talking about the free non-commutative but associative algebra. So its elements are polynomials, but the indeterminates don't commute with each other. So you just have formal words, and then you take their formal sums. And the question is, how do you? So, of course, since the polynomials, they're not invertible, you have to go to a larger ring to invert them. And this is the main difficulty, how you understand this larger ring. And so that's what most of this talk is going to be about. Now, since the larger ring, I actually wrote something here. So this is what I was saying, that we want to look in an overring. And now this free algebra is, I shouldn't have said integral domain, because in a non-commutative sense, you just say domain. And you want to put it in a division ring. So a division ring, for people who are not familiar with the terminology. By the way, if I say something, being from an algebraic background, then I use words that are unfamiliar, just stop me and ask me. So a division ring is a non-commutative field, essentially. You can invert elements, but you can't commute them. Okay, so that's what we want to do. Since the general theory, so I'm going to start with the general theory, because that's what I was most interested in. It's rather complicated. There are ways of simplifying it using representations, and we're going to do that at the end, maybe. So even though the theory is probably simpler for the finite dimensional case. Okay, so this theory is essentially was the baby of Paul Cohn from London about maybe 60 years ago. And his idea, which this is just a general overview, I'm going to get to specifics, but his idea was that if you want to understand the structure of these division rings, in fact, the matrices, you can study linear algebra over them, the same way you study linear algebra over fields, and you learn things from the linear algebra. So he studies these things, these full matrices. One basic property in linear algebra is that when you decompose a matrix as a product of other matrices, the ranks have to be at least as large as the rank of the original matrix. And so that's the idea of his full thing, that you can't decompose. And I can't seem, oopsie. I can't seem to get this, wait a second. Okay, there it is, full. So Cohn's original work was rather intricate and with many definitions and computations, and Malcolmson in particular managed to cut through a lot of these computations. So we're going to be speaking about Malcolmson's work a lot. And then other people who advanced the subject were Schofield, Bergman, and Westreich. I will maybe mention a bit about what they did, but that again begins to get technical, because essentially what Schofield did is he showed how what Cohn's work could be generalized in a very beautiful way, but which probably would be less interesting to the audience here. Okay, so you can't. Well, I'll define that in a word. It means that you cannot factor it into matrices of lower rank. In other words, if A equals BC, you cannot write the identity matrix, an invertible matrix, like the identity matrix, you cannot write as the product of two matrices of lower rank. That's essentially the basic property that he wants to make abstract. And we'll get to that. Okay, so that's enough of that slide. Oh, so this is essentially, I probably won't talk fast enough to go through all this, but so I'm going to start with this Cohn's theory of localization of matrix ideals, whatever that is, and which involves rank functions. And then actually, this I like a lot, so I hope I get to that. And this is a very beautiful non-commutative way of dealing with polynomials in one indeterminate. But again, it's only useful for elements which are algebraic, which are rare. So if we don't get to it, it's a wonderful theory, but it's not a tragedy if we don't get to that. Okay, so this is what I was talking about before. We start with this free algebra. Oops, I think I just point with my finger. And we want to adjoin all formal inverses. Now, one can do this in a formal way just by formally adjoining inverses. You do that for the free group, for example. But it's rather complicated. Ah, this is great. This is really good, thank you. So, but if you do this in algebras, there's no reason why, so you just do it formally. You just adjoin a lot of indeterminates. You have a bunch of equations, and you mod out by those relations. But you might get extra zero, you might get zero divisors, and so that might mess up the whole program. In fact, you don't. This can be embedded, but it's a non-trivial theorem. And one of the nicest proofs to do to Amitsu. So Cohn's method is through matrices. So it starts with a bunch of, a set of square matrices, which he wants to invert. And these will be the full matrices, by the way, when we get to that. And this is what I said before. You could just say, okay, I want to formally invert A inverse, which I'm going to call B now. And they have to, obviously, the entries, in order for the product to be the identity, this is the Kronecker delta, you have to have the usual relations that this is 1 when j equals I and 0 when j is not equal to I. And I'm just to join that, and that gives you what we call R sigma, the localization, and we call this map the homomorphism, and the question is whether it's 1-to-1. Okay, now Cohn's work, he has many, many definitions. One of the most important is UGN, unbounded generating number. Now, this means that any module, that there are large modules. Well, what are the large modules? Well, like R has rank 1, R squared has R times R has rank 2. You could take R to any power. So in theory, you could get any number of generators, you know, R to the million. But maybe R to the million is isomorphic to R to the 500,000. I mean, it's not going to happen in the commutative, if R is commutative. That's one of the basic theorems that to the a free module or a vector space has unique rank, unique dimension. But it could happen in ring theory, so we have to define it. So essentially, this means that the ring is reasonable, that you can't go down in dimensions. Or this way, if m is greater than n, if m is less than n, you cannot have this. Or if you have this, m has to be at least n. So this is a very basic property, happens in the free algebra, happens many algebras. But if you express it this way, then you can show instantly that if you have a homomorphism, if you had this, then it would go to the image. And therefore, if the image fails UGN, I'm sorry, if the image has UGN, then, in other words, if this cannot be, then the pre-homomorphic at the pre-homomorphic image upstairs at the at where it starts, then also this could not happen. So the pre-image of a UGN is a UGN. And so the free algebra is a pre-image of everything, so it's a UGN. Okay, so we said that any commutative ring is a UGN, so the free algebra is a UGN. It's a pre-image of the event, anything. Okay. So, in fact, this has a stronger property. That's a property of AB is the identity, then BA is the identity, which means this, that you have unique rank. That's certainly true for subrings, because it's a fortiori. I mean, if this holds in a bigger ring, it certainly holds in the smaller ring. And so once you know that fx is embeddable, then in fact, it can be put into a weakly finite ring, and therefore itself is weakly finite. So the free algebra satisfies this property, and this implies UGN. So so essentially what I was saying for the last 5 minutes was that the normal properties you expect for free modules hold over f of x. Okay, here's some notation. This is extremely important in the continuation because these are like block triangular matrices. If A and B are invertible, then it's easy to compute the inverse of this. You take A inverse here, B inverse here, and in the next slide we'll see what you put there. We want a notation for that. And when C is 0, we'll just write A dot A plus B that way. So A plus B means you put A here and B here. And A to the N will just be A plus itself N times A. And this is a useful factorization, which enables you to reduce to the case where B is the identity matrix. Because if you want to work with this, you can work with each of these individually. Okay, so this is what I was promising a minute ago, that this is the inverse of this. These two are inverses. Okay, so if all our matrices were upper triangular, we'd essentially be done, but we're not. So, this is full. Okay, so you define non-full or T non-full if you go down in the rank this way. But that's not good enough. You want to know whether if you tag on the identity diagonally, whether it's going to be non-full. So we say stably non-full. Actually, this isn't really what's used in the literature, but I think it's more evocative. And just if it's T non-full, then it's non-full with respect to anything less than T. So Some t-nonfold means one nonfold, so we'll just call that nonfold. Okay. Remember, let's say C is zero here. When we take A plus I, we're taking A and I here. Yeah. Almost 99% of our pluses will have dots. and so the thing is, the larger the identity, philosophically it's the same thing, but the larger the identity matrix, the more likely you'll get non-full. Although most of the time, you can just cancel the identity matrix altogether, because if you factor with an identity matrix, it sort of makes sense that you'll be able to somehow get rid of the identity matrix in the factorization. But that happens in the free algebra, but it doesn't happen in general. If the ring is weakly finite, then in fact stably non-full is. So we'll probably forget about stably for most of the time, because we were talking over weakly finite rings. Okay. Now, we're talking about the non-commutative algebra, but if we take the free commutative algebra, the polynomial ring, then in fact this is an anti-symmetric matrix. Any anti-symmetric matrix has determinant zero, so certainly it's invertible, but this is in fact full because these are indeterminates that you can't, because of degree considerations, you can't factor it into non-full matrices. So this is full, but with determinant zero. And so this is a matrix that we don't want to have, and it won't come up in the non-commutative setting. On the other hand, any invertible matrix is full. That was a counterexample to the converse. And invertibility is closed under this dot operation. Philosophically, and since the free algebra is weakly finite, and that's what we're interested in, we're going to assume weakly finiteness most of the time. Oh, right. This is Cohn's book. Cohn wrote two books about this. One is his book, Free Ideal Rings, is very famous. It's essentially the basic book on this kind of non-commutative matrix localization. Essentially, he was working for 20 years. He was working by himself. And then Bergman joined him, and Dix. And then Malcolmson, I think, was Bergman's student. Or maybe 10 years. I guess Bergman joined him pretty soon. But other than that, he was. He wrote a series of articles, which for when I was a student, it was sort of required reading for all the algebra students. So this was a long time ago, but he collected all these articles into this book that he called Free Ideal Rings. Okay. The other book, he wrote a book about division rings, and that's probably four. Here's a very basic idea that Gauss-Jordan, in principle, works. So in a sense, we're done again. And in fact, this is an article that Avi was a joint author of. I forget who the other person was from Seattle, I think, where they used this idea to invert matrices, generic matrices. Right, right, Right. I'm sorry. I'm terrible that way. So what you do, you simply use transformations. You observe that you don't need commutativity to create elementary transformations. So you could take row transformations and column transformations. So here, first you divide by A. You have to divide on one side or the other, though, because it's not commutative. So you divide by A to transfer this row to here. And then you multiply by D and subtract to transfer to here. And this expression is quite famous in the theory. When you take C, A inverse D, it's going to come up later. Okay? But you see, we got to a triangular matrix. We know everything about triangular matrices, so we're done. Okay, that's the idea. Okay, and so since you call this a multiplicative set, even though this notation is addition, but what can you do? Okay. The reason it's called a multiplicative set because when you invert sets in commutative algebra, you invert multiplicative sets. So therefore, you want to call this also multiplicative because you're inverting it. We already mentioned that the invertible matrices are multiplicative in this sense. Okay, so again, what Cohn did, he took this standard terminology from structure theory and sort of transferred it to matrices. So a matrix ideal is not an ideal, but it looks sort of philosophically like an ideal. So first of all, it has the element zero. So this, what you're supposed to think of here is a singular matrices, essentially. And of course, singular matrices aren't an ideal. You can have the sum of two singular matrices be non-singular. But it's sort of like an ideal. It's closed. It's not closed under the sum, but it's closed under the determinantal sum. That means if everything except one row is the same, then you can add those two rows, because if the determinant is zero of each of them, and you just have everything the same except for one row, then when you add the two rows, the determinant will still remain zero. And so that's why you call that the determinantal sum. And that's the idea behind that. And if you have if it's already singular, and you tack on an extra piece in the diagonal, it's going to remain singular, of course. Even if you make it triangular, because the determinant here times the determinant here is the determinant of the whole thing. So this is true for singular matrices. And this is also true for singular matrices. If you tack on the identity, it doesn't affect. So the singular matrices is the prototypical example of this. But this is the abstract definition. And you can perform Gaussian transformations on a matrix ideal. You can take the transpose. Taking the transpose enables you to go from upper triangle to lower triangle. And then you have this idea of a prime matrix ideal, which says that if you take this diagonal sum, if the sum is, well, think of again singular. If the sum is singular, singular isn't good enough here. This is the definition of prime. I mean, I guess you could have partial singularity here and partial singularity here. That's the definition that S was supposed to be full, I think. Oh, no, I'm sorry. No, this is okay. S and P are the same here. So it should have been a P. Okay, well, that's the definition of prime. If the sum is in P, then one is in P or the other. You see, remember that the sum is like the product, and an ideal is prime if the product of two things is in P, plus one and the other is in P. So this should have been a P, sorry. Okay. Okay, and then this shows the point of prime matrix ideals, that that you can realize them as pre-homomorphic images of non-full matrices if R goes into a division. Okay, so we don't actually need this theorem, it's just for motivation. Okay, this is important. And I'm not saying that it's an injection, it might have a kernel, but there is a homomorphism to a division ring if and only if you can outwrite the identity matrix as a determinantal sum of non-full matrices. And it's an injection if you have diagonal here instead of identity, if no diagonal matrix can be written as a determinantal sum. Okay, and this is the proof is non-trivial, of course, but one trivial part of the proof, which might give some intuition, is this. If the product of two elements is zero, then you see this is the same, so you can take the determinantal sum, this means the determinantal sum, and 1 plus minus 1 is 0, so you get this. And this is non-full, and this is non-full. So in other words, if you have zero divisors, you have a diagonal matrix, which is the determinantal sum of two non-full matrices. So this might give some intuition of what's going on here. Okay. If you want to take a look at it for a minute. Going the other way is harder. And this deserves its own slide. The invertible matrices are multiplicative, and when the full matrices are multiplicative, then in fact you get what you want. Of course, this doesn't say how to compute the inverses. That's the big question that we're dealing with, but at least it shows that we have a ballpark to play in. Okay, Malcolmson, so this was Cohn's big theorem, by the way. This was why everybody was interested in his work. And I don't know why it's a proposition. I guess because we want to study when the full matrices are multiplicative. So when Malcolmson came, he actually made some very interesting observations considerably after Cohn's work, that this unbounded generating number, or whatever that was, this holds in R sigma if and only if sigma contains only the full matrices, only full matrices. It doesn't have to be all of them. In Cohn's work, he took sigma to be all of the full matrices. That's this localization. Did I not define it? I think it's probably on a subsequent slide. One uses these matrices. Oh no! We did define it. This is this formal ring that you get by inverting formally the matrices of sigma, taking. I remember we had these equations that's R sigma. You don't have to iterate it. Cohn's theorem, I'm pretty sure you don't have to iterate it. At one point I thought you do, but looking through his book the other day, he had this theorem that after one step, if you use the full matrices, if you have in particular the free algebra, in general a Sylvester domain, we're going to define that soon, then one step will give you this division. But that's an excellent question, because theoretically, or let's say ideologically, you might invert the elements of R, but you don't get to a division ring. You get to another ring, and then if you're lucky, which is true in most of the cases, then you'll have other, you still have a domain, and you can invert those, and then you do an infinite process, and you get to a division ring. But Cohn, if I read his book correctly, Cohn said that this happens after the first step. Cohn's quotient ring is the R sigma, where sigma is all the full matrices. Okay, and it's weakly finite, if and only if this condition holds. Okay. So these are two very nice results of Malcolmson. Okay, now we're getting to rank functions. So this is typical properties of the ranks that you're all familiar with, of matrices. And if you take the diagonal sum, then it's the sum of the ranks. If you take this, then C might actually increase the rank, because it might have non-zero entries. So you have this. So these are all. And if you have this kind of abstract function, then you can get a homomorphism to a simple Artinian ring. I changed the slide last night. I think that, in fact, if R is a domain with this rank function, and here just it's an algebra, if it is a domain with this rank function, I think then you can take E equals D. I think I'd give equal 1 here. That's right, and this is what I was saying, that that rho over the division ring is just the usual rank. A Sylvester rank function has this extra property, which is also true in commutative algebra, that if you have two matrices that annihilate each other, then the sum of the rank is at most n. And then there's this basic theorem, which is what I quoted about 10 minutes ago, that I said if it's a Sylvester domain, it's actually equivalent to R being a Sylvester domain. R is a Sylvester domain if and only if you get Cohn's quotient ring is a division. And he also has this extra, he has four conditions. The fourth one didn't seem as interesting, but this is very interesting, that the set of all full matrices is a prime matrix ideal, because we discussed prime matrix ideals. Okay, so that's it for Cohn's work. Malcolmson came, and he found a really nice, when you asked what Cohn's localization is, it's quite complicated. And it has rather large matrices. Malcolmson came, and he showed how you can view it much more simply. So that's why we're postponing the matrix construction for now. The intuition is that if you have a row and a square matrix and then a column, the product will be an element. It will be 1 times 1. 1 times n, n times n, n times 1 gives you 1 times 1. So it'll give you something like a new element. And these are exactly the elements of the localization. The elements of the localization should be thought of as a row matrix times a square matrix times a column matrix. And that will be more, and that will have these new formal elements. And you can think of it this way. Okay. And you will write it as this triple. So we won't write down the inverse there, but we're thinking of this like that. But meanwhile, we haven't, okay, so we're going to consider this kind of triple even if A is not invertible. And we'll see what happens, because we want to make A invertible. So A will normally be full, but not necessarily invertible. Okay, so you have these matrices, probably the full matrices. The sigma can be any set, multiplicative set. And Malcolmson observed that you should focus on sigma. You shouldn't focus on all the matrices. And so he requires A to be in sigma, okay? And then he defines a matrix ideal with respect to that. So A is in sigma, and then he takes the rest of the definition, that you can take determinantal sums, et cetera. And then he has prime, also the same. But instead, this is why I had the misprint before, because I actually copied this slide there. Now he says something very similar, but if A is in sigma and the sum is an S, then B has to be an S. That's like saying that if you have an invertible element times something else, then the thing is there. And that's a prime pair. Okay, so you have the multiplicative set and the sigma ideal. The standard prime pair is you take the invertible elements and the non-full matrices. Okay. Okay, now we construct, finally construct the matrix version of the localization, the matrix notation of the localization. First, we have to define when two of these are to be identified, and that's when this happens. And the proof that this is an equivalence relation took like two-thirds of this paper. Okay, that was, but Westreich, his equivalence was more complicated. I think it was maybe 4 by 4 something. Westreich observed that you only had to make this observation and that the exact same proof worked. So she just quoted his proof. But anyway, and then you have addition, where you sort of just essentially juxtapose. And you have multiplication, which is a bit more complicated. Maybe this requires a bit of explanation. Remember, V is a column vector, and G is a row vector. So when you multiply a column vector and a row vector, you get an N by N matrix. And you take the negation, and that's the C that you stick in the side. Okay, so anyway, I'm sure, you know, on a first reading, this doesn't say a great deal. I mean, this is pretty clear. If you worked out what this means intuitively, you would wind up with that. Okay, and then you also want an algebra structure. You want the scalar multiplication, so you just stick that in the vector. And remember, this is like FA inverse V. Okay, so we're going to call this RQ. Remember, we had R sigma before, so this is a generalization. Okay, and this is sort of obvious if you take the unit matrix here, and so you invert that and you multiply by R, then you get R. Okay. Oh, this is very nice. This shows you when the image, so you have, on the last slide, I had this injection of R into the localization, and the image of an element is of this form if and only if you wind up, this is like the non-full matrices, if you wind up in this matrix ideal. And in fact, the kernel of that map is precisely this S. And I guess it would have to be the, this doesn't make so much sense, because phi C was from R. So it would have to be the 1 by 1 matrices, I guess, that that doesn't make sense. I don't know. I have to think about that. And but if A is in sigma, then C of A is invertible, and you have this. So this is very important. This says that this mapping. Okay, I think I understand that. Yeah. This mapping is multiplicative. But what this means, what this must mean is that if you extend C component-wise to the matrices, then the that also doesn't make sense. I don't know. Let's skip this one because but this one, you see, this one makes sense. You apply it to the components of the matrices, and it'll work. This one, I as I'm standing up here on my feet, it couldn't be that it's component-wise because that would mean each component would go to zero, and that doesn't make sense. So, but this is very important because it shows you that C is sort of a homomorphism. Okay. So we haven't yet claimed that it's a division ring. And in fact, in this generality that Malcolmson did, you can have one prime matrix ideal contained in another prime matrix ideal. And sometimes, well, it depends. He has a criterion exactly when RQ will be RQ prime. But it doesn't have to be. It's like you take prime ideals and maximal ideals. Yeah, so you don't necessarily, if you take a prime ideal and you localize, you don't. You certainly don't get a field in general. So Westreich essentially found the kind of prime pair where you localize and get a semi-simple ring. A semi-simple ring, if people aren't familiar with the terminology, that's a direct product of matrices over division rings, finite direct product. So semi-simple rings are the basic rings in algebra, essentially. So it's important to know when RQ is semi-simple. But she has a technical result. It kind of bound on the size of the non-fullness, that you can't, that's essentially what this condition means, that remember we described T non-fullness. In other words, you can't factor in so that the rank gets lost more than T. That just the minimal decrease in rank in the factorization, I'm sorry, the maximal decrease in rank in the factorization must be T. That's her condition here. And then you get a semi-simple ring. Okay, so this is a rather, this is a bit technical, but I think it's a nice, theorem. And then when you take the, of course, T equals N here. Sorry about that. No, here's the N, So when you have this happening, the smallest N gives you the size of the semisimple. That's not really so relevant to what we're doing because we're more interested in domains and division rings, not in semisimple. But okay. So that's essentially it for the Cohn-Malcolmson theory, but and I just want to take a couple of minutes, and then if we can decide if we want to take a break after this, just to describe what happens in general. Just because we've gotten this far after 50 minutes, and it's beautiful results which people almost never see. And so I just want to mention them. Okay, so Cohn's original, I mentioned that the title of his book is Free Ideal Rings, because that's what he was interested in. And it turns out that the free algebra is a free ideal ring. But so he did this for free ideal rings. Everything I said he did for free ideal rings, and or fur. That's so his school talked about furs. I don't know if you've heard about a fur outside of the forest, but and there's this Russian guy Gerasimov who also came into the picture, and so essentially, if you localize a fur, you stay with the fur. And so there's this theory of furs, which really takes half his book. Okay. So there's that. And then Schofield came quite a bit later. I think he also was a student of Cohn. And he observed, see, matrices is a rather old-fashioned way of, I mean, even then was old-fashioned of dealing things because it's not categorical. There's this idea of a projective module, which probably everybody's seen in their life, but I just wanted to remind you about that, that if you have a onto a module map, then the, I'm sorry, this should be M. Then P to M lifts to P to M. And the idea is if you have a free module, then you can just take the image here and lift its set theoretically to M, because this is onto. And then for free module, you can always define a homomorphism from the generators to whatever you want. So any free module is, it's a, you know, a two-minute exercise, which I sketched now. A free module is projective. And projectives, in fact, are direct summons of free modules. So on the one hand, they're defined categorically, but on the other hand, they're essentially the same theory as free modules. And so what Schofield did is he generalized everything to projective modules. The big difference is that the rank of a free module has to be an integer. The rank of a projective module would be a fraction, because if you have like the projective module to the nth power being some free module, then you'd have to divide the rank by m in order to make things work. So he, or n here I had. So he defined the projective rank that way. And then he got a Sylvester rank function. And he had a general theory of rings with Sylvester rank functions, which is beautiful. He wrote a book about it. And it's much harder to read than Cohn's book. It's one of the hard books to read in the subject. And he has beautiful theorems. So that's, I had his book. What is it called? It's in the LMS series. And using this, he completely generalized things. He found how you take an arbitrary ring and characterize it in terms of Sylvester rank functions when you can embed it in a simple Artinian ring. So it's a beautiful result. And then you can use it to compare rings. For example, he can give you examples using his theory of R is embeddable in 2x2 matrices over D, but not into D. And that was a question that people couldn't answer before his book, or before his theory. Bergman came around, I don't know if you know Bergman. He's, you know, at Berkeley, and he was a wunderkind as a student, and did all sorts of interesting things which nobody else thought of. And so what he did here is he took Schofield's approach with Sylvester rank functions and translated it to matroids, which I think probably people have dealt with matroids here. And matroids, one application of matroids is dependence on vectors. And you can do this over an arbitrary ring, and that's what he does here. He has a axiomatism. Actually, I have his paper in my office. I don't want to go into it because it's quite abstract and technical, but he can do all this in the language of matrices. And Westreich. So what did Schofield do? And Schofield's criterion, he actually had two stages. This related to what you asked before. Matrix localization is not enough. You have to take coproducts after the matrix localization and observe that the coproduct of two spheres is a sphere. And Westreich found that you don't have to use coproducts, that you can use something more similar to what we were talking about before. You can do a triangular matrix ring where the C is the tensor product of A and B, and then you can get up to these simple identity rings. I think that's everything for this. Right. So the question is, what do we want to do now? Should I continue on, or should you want to take a break? Or? Yeah, right. Okay. Because this is completely different from. Theory of inverting elements of the free algebra. And of course, classically, customarily, one often studies algebras in terms of finite dimensional representations or other kinds of representations. But here we're interested in finite dimensional representations. And the idea being very simple that you have this thing called a polynomial identity. That's a non-commutative polynomial which vanishes basically on every substitution in an algebra. And of course, the free algebra, by definition, has no polynomial identities because all of its are distinct. They're all so essentially, you get a polynomial identity when you have a homomorphism from the free algebra you always have homomorphisms from the free algebra to an arbitrary algebra. If for all of those homomorphisms, some given polynomial always is in the kernel, always goes to zero, that's called the polynomial identity. Okay, so almost by definition, okay, so matrices have polynomial identities. I don't think I went into that here, but we'll go into that. Okay, the commutative algebra has a polynomial identity x1, x2 minus x2, x1. Any homomorphism to a commutative algebra, x2 goes to x2, x1. So the difference is a polynomial identity. Matrix algebras, that's about the first theorem in the subject, was that they satisfy different polynomial identities. We'll probably get to that in a minute when we talk about central polynomials. The 2x2 are very famous. And as you go up, you have fewer and fewer polynomial identities, of course. And so the intersection is zero. So that means that for any given polynomial, there will be some representation in which that is non-zero. So that's the whole idea here. We just want to find out how far we have to go up to get this non-zero representation. Now, that's not very difficult because I should have written this on a slide, but I didn't. If you have Eij being the matrix with 1 in the ij component and 0 elsewise, if you take E12, E23, E34, you can even do this better. I'm doing this in a very crude way, but I think this is the best way, actually, for computations. If you have a polynomial and you make these substitutions, this can only be non-zero in this order. I mean, this has been known for years and years, right? Because if you have E34 before E23, you'll get 0 when you multiply them together. So if you have some non-commutative polynomial of degree n in n by n matrices, it has to already be non-zero because you just make the substitution in this order. I don't recall having put that down here. So for polynomials, this question is sort of trivial. You have a polynomial, and you can see that it's non-zero in n by n matrices if the polynomial is degree n. But when you have rational expressions, it becomes an interesting question. So that's essentially, so that's what I want to talk about. I have 2 because I gave the argument for n greater than the degree of f. You can actually throw in E11, E12, E22, E23. But I think the reason I didn't do that, I think if we go further with this and do computations, I think it's better to not have the idempotents, just to have those. And since it's just a factor of 2, that's computationally, it doesn't make such a big difference. So the point of this is that Malcolmson's construction describes how you write down the matrices you want to invert. So in fact, and you remember his operations with juxtaposition. So that gives you an exponential bound, which exists but isn't so nice. Because one of the difficulties here is that the theory seems to work very nicely, but not with things that are so easily computed. That's right. This is a misleading statement, what I wrote down. What I meant here is that if you forget about the representation and just look at Malcolm's construction, it gives you this juxtaposition, and then you represent it. In other words, you have to represent it in some way that you don't lose information. Yeah, this is written in, there's a lot that has to be, clarified about that. But I think philosophically this is true, that you take Malcolmson's thing, you create the matrix expression, and then you represent the matrix expression. In terms of, you take the indeterminates, and each indeterminate you're going to take as a matrix, in other words. It's not obvious, but I think it works out that way. You're right, I haven't written this down, but I think it will work out because The presentation today is really about the general theory rather than the ideas, but we could talk about them, of course. I think what you want to do is you want to represent an expression so that when you evaluate it, you get two invertible matrices. And I'm going to get to that to some degree here. But if you want to, now you could evaluate it on what are called generic matrices. And then you have complete generality. The problem with generic matrices is that a generic matrix, so this is like an introduction to what I'm about to say, but a generic matrix has a distinct indeterminate in each entry. That's why it's called generic. And so when you compute with generic matrices, it's the most general way you can compute. And that's what they did with this paper, essentially, they were computing generic matrices. But then, again, the graph theory is a complete graph. It's very, very difficult to work with. So I think what one really wants to do is take a cycle, not a generic matrix, but something like this, where there are indeterminates attached to each thing. And then, but then you have to go back to one, or else it won't be invertible. When you multiply these together, you get a rank one matrix, of course, because these are all rank one. So you'll take EN1, and then you'll cyclically permute these also, so that you'll get all the diagonal entries, right? And I think essentially that's what you want to work with. And I'm not sure that I'm relating to your question, but anyway, the challenge is that this evaluation might not be invertible anyway, but at least it gives you a chance of being invertible. And my hope is that this would be sub-exponential, but I don't know whether it will succeed, you know, and this is something that we want to, you know, discuss but with this particular thing, it does require work, but I guess instead of saying provides, I should say it's likely to provide. Okay. Oh, this is important. This ring. So I mentioned the generic matrix ring. I think that's going to be in the next slide anyway. Another way of thinking. Let's see if it's. It won't be for a while, but. I can still talk about this ring. You take all the identities of n by n matrices. That's a set of polynomials, and it turns out to be an ideal in the free algebra. It's called a T-ideal, in fact. And it's a special kind of ideal. Define this to be the, you define this quotient, and this can be embedded in division algebra. Not only can this be invented in division algebra, but you can do it by inverting the center, which is much, much nicer than what we were talking about before. And what are these central elements? These central elements are polynomials, which always go to scalar matrices. Because if you commute with anything, you get an identity. So these central polynomials are going to be very important. So I could have said central polynomials here. These are what I, so let me just repeat. What I mean by a central polynomial is a polynomial for this n, which always takes scalar values. The n, of course, depends. And we're going to go, okay. This is an important technical definition, but I mean, it's very basic to the computational theory of polynomial identities. If you put two the same, then you get zero. Or in other words, they alternate. If you have xi, xj, and you switch it by xj, xi, then you get the negative. It's exactly what happens with the symmetric group, for example. It's and the theory is just like the theory of the symmetric group, and it makes things look like determinants. And this is the big problem, actually, because determinants, I mean, how complicated are determinants? I mean, that's, you know, and the, if you're going to do things with determinants, then you're stuck with the classical questions of how do you manipulate determinants. But this is exactly like a determinant. In fact, you see, you can define this kind of polynomial. And this kind of polynomial, where the coefficient is plus or minus 1, depending on how you permute the variables. And this has a lot of properties of the determinant. It's the same theory almost. OK. There are two examples of this. This is very famous. This is the standard polynomial. Sure, you want to hear it in a math lecture. Anyway, so but it's too good because it's too small in a sense. There's the Capelli polynomial where you put it where you put fixed indeterminates in between. The reason that this is more useful is because again, if you have any alternating polynomial, T alternating polynomial, it's automatically an identity for T plus, for T minus one dimensional algebra, for any algebra of dimension less than T, because you take, you can reduce to a base, and when you have a base, you have fewer than T elements. So when you substitute, two of them have to be the same, and by definition of alternating, that makes zero. So, I hope I didn't say that too fast. Let me go back to this definition of alternating. See, if you put two of the same, you get zero. So if you have an algebra of dimension less than t, you can always reduce to substituting in base elements by linearity. So then you get zero. So any, let's say any n squared plus 1 alternating algebra, that's polynomial, will be an identity of n by n matrices, which has dimension n squared. The standard polynomial, you don't need n squared plus 1. S2n is an identity. But in a sense, that's not quite what you want at this in this case, because you want something that will measure the size of the set that you're substituting on. So here, the Capelli will C n squared will give you a zero element, a zero evaluation, if and only if the span of the vectors you put in. Okay, on a vector space at least, is less than n squared. In other words, so it will measure the size of the space it's acting on, whereas S2n won't, because it will be too good. It will be zero too often from that point of view. So Oh, but the YT is unnecessary. But because if you don't have Y1 to YT, then you get the standard polynomial, and it vanishes too quickly. Let me put it a different way. Let me write down all the matrix units. Well, I'm not going to write them all down. But I could write down n squared matrix units. I want something here. I wrote them here so that the product is non-zero. But here, when I get to E1n, I guess I have to write a bit more. Then I start with E21, right? And then you go to E22 to E2n. So I want to get the product of these n squared to be non-zero. But I can't do it. The best I could have done is 2n. That's why the Amisulovsky, because I could do E11, E12. But what I can do, so these are the x's. What I can do for the y's is put what's missing here. So here I put E11. It really should go here. I'm just writing it down here because I don't have the different. Oh, I do have a different color chalk. That's great. OK, so I put E11 here. Now here I put E21, see, to keep the chain going. Here I put E31, keep on going. Here I put EN2. So this keeps on going. It's non-zero. And if I permute any two of the x's, I messed it up. So it gives zero. So it's the same argument that said, but here I have a chain of n squared that gives me non-zero. And that's exactly the argument. That's what I was hinting at before. I think this answers the question. So that's why you need the y's. You need the y's to put in those red things so that for n squared you get a non-zero evaluation here instead of for 2n. Okay. This I said. And the point of with the Capelli is that you have the converse. Okay. So and this we already talked about, how you have to have degree at least 2n. And I also said that I don't like these idempotents, so okay. And this is what I was just explaining. Oopsie. Right? How do I get all of this? This is what I have, right? Okay. This is really important. This is the key to this half hour, whatever it is. If you have an alternating polynomial, the fact that this looks like the determinant, in fact, when you take a matrix, rough multiplication by the matrix applied to the first n, alternating to the first n elements, if you have an n by n matrix, or n dimensional subspace, I'm sorry, and a transformation of that, then when you pull out the A's, you get the determinant. This was, I think, first observed by Amisulov. And what this means is it's a way of expressing the determinant as a quotient of two polynomials. Although these might not be invertible, so you have to work on that. So this is the key to what we're talking about. Because we want to invert things, and the way you invert things is, when you invert matrices is you invert the determinant. And you can invert the determinant in terms of polynomials. But these polynomials can be very complicated. Later on it's going to say proposition 15, and you might notice that I'm not capable of getting the 15 up here. But when it says proposition 15, it means this. Okay. And, okay. So I just said that's a philosophical proof, of course. Trace identities. Okay, I think that probably one wants to use the trace inside the language, because the trace is easy to compute, and we'll see. Okay, I'll explain why the trace is so crucial in a minute. But first of all, this isn't the usual polynomial identity, but using Newton's formulas, you get an identity with the formal operation of the trace, which I'm sure everybody is familiar with. And in fact, if you take the Hamilton-Cayley polynomial with traces, that implies every trace identity and every polynomial identity. This is a theorem. This is just pointing out that you can use traces. Yeah, this is important. So this is a fundamental theorem of invariant theory, which was done in the 70s. And Razmyslov, I guess I don't have the, didn't put in the citation properly, proved, I mean, in theory, you could prove every single theorem about polynomial identities using trace identities. And he did this explicitly. It's not trivial, though. If I give you a polynomial, it's not clear at all how it follows from, you know, if it's an identity, how it follows from a trace identity. That's an interesting computational question, by the way. Okay, central polynomials. So this is what I was saying before. If it takes on scalar values, here's some nice examples. So any commutative ring, of course, X is central. But this is cute. If you take a commutator of two by two matrices, it certainly has trace zero. But if it has trace zero, if you look at the Cayley-Hamilton formula, it means the square is the negative of the determinant, which is a scalar. So that means that this is scalar. Okay? It's minus, I mean, it has trace zero, so its value is minus the determinant of x1, x2. Oh, this is the additive commutator, x1, x2 minus x2, x1. And so Kaplansky asked this, and Formanoch and Razmyslov proved that it does. This is Razmyslov's proof. It might be appropriate to understanding computations. A weak identity is when you apply it to trace zero matrices. And so the one that Razmyslov used was C n squared, because as I mentioned before, since this has dimension n squared minus 1, oopsie, that was save. Okay. So since it has dimension n squared minus 1, it has to vanish on any n squared alternating thing. But this is an n squared weak identity. You want to get down to a one weak identity eventually. So you just put in the number of commutators. And each time you do this, you decrease it by one. So this polynomial is a bit more complicated than that. But when you take enough commutators, you get down to one. That's this. And so you get a one-weak identity of M and F. That's not an identity, because the Capelli is not an identity to begin with. And what's that good for? Well, I don't know. This is getting a little technical, but if you take It is called a generalized identity if the coefficients can be in your base ring. And so we have a generalized identity with one indeterminate. And and this is true essentially because you can take the transpose. M and FF is closed under transpose. So you take the, this works out because it takes an argument, but the main step is using the transpose. And if you compute a little bit more, you see that this expression is scalar always for all x, if and only if this expression is zero for every matrix of trace zero. Because somehow, when you take the transpose, well, it's an argument, but you take the transpose of an expression that you get from here, and you get somehow you get a commutator. Ah, I think I could say something which makes sense. What does this mean? This is central. It means that you commute with something and you get zero. And then you, if you take that and you fiddle around, oopsie, you can manage to get to bring the commutator next to x. And then you have r being the commutator x and something, and that has trace zero. R has trace zero. So that's okay. It actually would only take 10 minutes to give the argument. So that's what Rasmusov proved. Rasmusov actually proved this using the Casimir element in the Lie algebra. He had a nice proof through Lie algebra, but it was rather complicated. But what I said 3 minutes ago is essentially you take that argument and you just translate it into taking the matrix transpose. And you get this, but anyway,
this is pretty much what I was talking before. What you're going to do when we had these AIs and BIs, we're going to take them to be polynomials, of course, and then manipulate with them. Okay. Anyway, in what I was saying for the last 5 minutes, in summary, he starts with this weak identity, which I said before. We start with the Capelli identity. We turn indeterminates into commutators to get trace zero elements. We do that trick, and that gives us a central polynomial. Okay. We reverse. We use the trick to reverse. Let me try to say it a bit more, so it makes a bit more sense. Where's our, we take these, we write this one-weak identity. Where was our one-weak identity? Our one-weak, so we started with the Capelli polynomial. F was the Capelli polynomial. That was cn squared. We do this trick, n squared minus 1 times, to get g. We write g, we pick out x1 inside g, and we write g as summation ai x1 bi. In other words, the ai and the bi are polynomials which don't involve x1. So g has a bunch of monomials. In each of the monomial, x1 appears somewhere in the middle. And so what appears before x1 we call ai. What appears after x1 we call bi. And that gives us something of this form. I guess r is x1. And then we do this. We do this reversal trick. And so we started with a weak identity where the x1 was in the middle. And then when we switch these around, lo and behold, we get a central polynomial. That's Rasmusov's proof. in a nutshell. Fobenex proof is completely different. Fobenex proof was graph theory. Anyway, and its construction was completely different. But we have it. That's what we wanted. Now, the Capelli polynomial is, I think that this theory shows that every central polynomial can be obtained in this way, because what did we do? We took a weak identity and changed it to a central polynomial. We could have taken a central polynomial, changed it to a weak identity, and used the weak identity to recover the central polynomial, because we have like this kind of switch thing. So in principle, Rasmussen's approach is completely general. You can get any central polynomial if you're smart enough to pick the right one identity. So Fomenek student Halpin found a better one than the Capelli. So, and he got n squared. And for a while, people thought n squared was the best. That's the degree of the polynomial. But then somebody found for degree 3, you get for matrices 3 by 3, you could get degree 8. Dreitsky's student. And so nobody knows really what the answer is there. And then for 16, what do you get? 16, I think they got 13 or something like that. So this is actually a wonderful question about computing. I don't know. People sort of gave up on this about 30 years ago because they couldn't deal with n greater than 4 on the computer. But now, of course, you could. So Fomenek came up with this quadratic formula on the basis of 2 squared is 4, 8 is 3 squared minus 1, and 13 is something. And so anyway, he fit a quadratic polynomial to those 3 points. And nobody's disproved his conjecture yet until they go up to 5. But anyway, there are ways of checking identities, which is actually something that that we probably should discuss. So we'll just say Pi cross N if it satisfies the identities of N by N matrices. Essentially, we're saying any algebra that whose identities look like those of matrices, we'll say has Pi cross N. And if you localize, you don't change the PI class. But why did I say it's too crude? I don't understand the statement. But essentially, we want to look at matrices and look at the central polynomials and use them to compute inverses. How are we going to do that? This is obvious because if you take a homomorphism, then the polynomial is based on arithmetic operations. So it gives you the same, it commutes with the homomorphism. So I want to take a polynomial which is not an identity. And I want to say that there's some evaluation which is non-zero in which x1 is e11. And the reason is because you can manipulate and get to e11. What did we do here? If it's always zero, then this is always zero. The f is linear, so f has some value b, and you add e11, it doesn't change things. But now you can conjugate and get to e11. And so you get down zero. Okay, so that's computationally rather easy also. This is what you want. Okay, so we had this evaluation where the Capelli is non-zero, where this was E11. This is why I wanted to get to E11. And so you do that. You take some value, which gives you E11. You take the Capelli, which gives you E11. And you take this thing for Gn, which gives you non-zero for E11 and other things. That's what I did in the last slide. And then we just put it indeterminate. So you're going to have this thing being central, because this is a central polynomial. And it's going to have a non-zero value, because this will, some value here will be E11, and then you have other things which give you non-zero. So formally, this polynomial will be a central polynomial, which is alternating. We did this to make this alternating. So we have an alternating central polynomial. Now, this is computationally quite disastrous, right? Because you start with the Capelli polynomial, which is already complicated. You use Rasmyslov's construction, which was even more complicated. And so this is a really complicated polynomial of degree, I think, 4n². I think you might be able to roll it to 2n² or something, if you. But it's a large degree, and its graph, the monomials, are many monomials. So, but we have this, and let's say in principle we could get a better polynomial. How do we use this? So we have an n² alternating central polynomial. That's what we want. So I guess t is n² here. If you have a t alternating polynomial, you can alternate it further with another variable and make a t plus 1 alternating polynomial. Okay, that's a key assertion. And then if you do that, you can rewrite that as saying that this is equal to the sum of all the other terms when we built this t plus 1 thing. And okay, so this is the proof. And this is what we want. Okay, so what does this mean? This means you take R, you multiply it by this evaluation, and you get, these are all central, so you get a scalar combination of these other elements. So in other words, I start with R1 to Rn², I take any R, and I can express R times this as a linear combination of these. This is all follows from the fact that this is, what was the point? If T is n², if this is n² plus 1 alternating, then it's an identity for n by n matrices. So therefore, you get this thing holding for n by n matrices. Okay. Well, if this is 1, then you've written R as a linear combination of these. So this is a way, this is a computational way of writing any matrix as a linear combination of a base of other matrices, which theoretically it's very nice. I mean, it's a very good tool theoretically. Computationally, you know, it's pretty complicated to compute these, but they are computable. I mean, they're explicit. But it's, you know, what, 4n² factorial, something like that. And it's very big. Not very big, but it's big. So where are we? If you can do this, but you can do this. It's a one-shot thing that you just have to find that kind of evaluation. Okay, so this is what I was saying before, that these span the matrices. Oh, and they're also independent. This is another argument, this similar kind of argument. So I was just saying that
you can do this because you can multiply by scalars. Okay. This is why I was saying this, that other proposition, which I said was very important, that enables you to remove the determinant. I tried to stress that before. So what you wind up with is this. Now, how is this different than that famous proposition 15? Proposition 15 was for any alternating polynomial, but this is for the central alternating polynomial, which means that you can divide by it, and central elements you can divide by formally. We took the relatively free algebra, and we inverted central elements to get to division algebra. That was enough to get to division algebra. So that means that this is a permitted operation. We're taking a central element and dividing by it. And so we're computing inside this division algebra, and you get this. You get where these are the characteristic coefficients of A. I think I can say this better in the next slide. Wait. Meanwhile, not. If you take A tilde to be this, then you think of the Cayley-Hamilton theorem. And of course, that involves characteristic coefficients times, which are the coefficients of the complementary power of the indeterminate. I mean, so when you write the, so if you have the Cayley-Hamilton expression for A, if this is the Cayley-Hamilton polynomial of A, then you have this fact. And lambda is an indeterminate, so you could take the powers of lambda, and for each power of lambda, you get a different equation. And that's what I'm going to do. And I'm beginning to run out of time. So you have the relatively free algebra, which we just defined before, which this is just various properties of that. And we're interested for the identities of N by N matrices. This is important. You can explicitly write the relatively free algebra as generated by these generic matrices, a separate indeterminate in each entry. That's an explicit way of writing down the relatively free algebra. Instead of writing indeterminates, non-commutative indeterminates, in the free algebra, you get the relatively free algebra by writing these generic matrices with distinct indeterminate entries in each position. Okay. And it's enough to take any cardinality. That's a useful fact, but I want to get to... So this algebra, this is a prime algebra. In fact, it's a domain. And you get, as I said before, you get a division algebra by inverting central elements. And we'll call that UDN. So this is called the universal something, division, I guess, the algebra of N by N matrices. It's the generic algebra where we invert the central elements. And you can do this with traces also, and you get the same thing. And I think it's better to do it with traces, because then you can use Newton's formula. And this is what I wanted to get to. This is the main part of of this portion of the talk. A satisfies this algebraic equation. And so you can solve for A inverse by inverting the constant coefficient, which is the determinant. This is standard, right? When you have something like this,
you invert A by inverting the constant coefficient. And this is what you get by inverting constant coefficient. So this is an explicit formula. Pretty messy, but it's an explicit formula for inverting a matrix. And that was the object of what. So ideologically, in the first hour, we described that you can invert the matrix theoretically, but we don't know how. I mean, we know how, but we don't know how to compute it, really. Here, we can, or computing it involves taking these huge matrices. Here, we are still within the n by n. These are all n by n matrices. We compute within n by n matrices, and we can, and we have an explicit way of defining the inverse of a generic matrix. Okay, well, that was that. Now, I think there are like 3 minutes left, so I don't think there's really time for this. I didn't expect there would be time for this, actually. But it's a really beautiful theory, so anybody who's interested, I'd be happy to discuss it with them. See, the last thing that we did, we took the Cayley-Hamilton formula and we inverted it with that formula. In general, what if you have some algebraic element, like a matrix? How do you deal with its minimal polynomial? And because the minimal polynomial is over f, but it's irreducible. Over the division algebra, if you look at non-commutative polynomials, you can factorize it into a product of linear polynomials. This is an amazing theorem that is close to its 100th anniversary, by the way. We should have a party or something. I think it was 1922. And I'm going to finish with just, you know, a few general words about that. So in usual commutative algebra, you have irreducible polynomials, degree, you know, arbitrary degree. Here you take the minimal polynomial of an algebraic element, it's always reducible. It's always reducible into linear factors. So this is a fantastic theorem. And the reason being that you use the non-commutativity to continue the factorization. And it would take another 10, 15 minutes, but I think, you know. So it's this thing here. Okay. So that's, I guess that's probably, you know, good place to finish.